Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
Welcome to Space News. This is Andy Hall, and over the course of the past year, I've been presenting a multi-part series called Eye of the Storm. Eye of the Storm presents a case study for how electrical forces shape the Colorado Plateau and its surroundings. In this 10th and final chapter, there are a few things to conclude and review in summary. What we've done in these chapters is reverse engineer the Earth, starting with outside layers and peeling inward, following the patterns of electrical scarring. We logically assumed circuitry is the fundamental structure of the planet, since that is the very structure of life, energy, and the cosmos in general. Abstract theories for cause and effect aren't needed when the patterns of nature are laid bare for us to see, repeating at every scale and every structure in the universe. We merely need to recognize what makes the patterns. In the case of geology, it's not just gravity, the mists of time, or coincidence. It's the diffusion of charge in an environment of extreme electrical stress. Meaning in the case of the Colorado Plateau, a huge potential difference between the Earth and something else. Charge diffusion means there is a circuit. Whether an element of charge finds a bond in atomic structure or drifts in patterns formed by fields, it has to move. And that motion is subject to a myriad of emergent influences. But it is always patterned in the most fundamental way by the coherent influence of electrical circuitry. Whether a chemical reaction or a thermodynamic cycle, dissect it down to the quantum level, and it's all electromagnetic circuitry. And as a result, we can look at the planets and stars in the solar system and see the same effects at play over and over. If a planet has dead circuits like Mercury or the Moon, facing a high potential, it responds to static charge buildup on its surface with explosive discharges that leave it pockmarked with craters and rills. The evidence is overwhelming, as anyone who reads Thunderbolts knows. Then there are planets that used to be alive and are now dead, like Mars, or those in the process of birth or death, like Venus. And there's a bunch of debris from planet formation and electrical interactions orbiting the Sun. But if a planet is alive, with an atmosphere and crust enveloped in a self-amplifying magnetosphere and sustained resonant feedback with the solar system, it must have energy flowing through that crust and atmosphere, storing inside it, making it a spherical capacitor. Weather in geology is driven by this capacitance. That is pure logic and physics once it's recognized that Earth and the solar system are circuits. Correlations can be drawn because circuitry acts the same regardless of what planet it's on, depending on type. Hence, we can see Jupiter's storms being motivated by circuitry and correlate actions of turbulent wind with geologic patterns on Earth and draw conclusions about the common cause. We don't have to theorize. We just apply known science. Mountain structures shaped by sonic shock waves provide the biggest evidence of all the electric Earth theories presented in the Eye of the Storm. If tetrahedrons and other features produced by shock waves in a wind tunnel precisely match what we see in geology, and if there is no other demonstrable process that can produce the same features, that is astonishing evidence that supersonic plasma winds built mountains. If supersonic plasma winds are acknowledged, then the planet's voltage rise and other circumstances required to create them have to be acknowledged as well. And that brings all the other electrical processes described in Eye of the Storm into play, because they are inevitable consequences of charge diffusion under those circumstances. Consensus science has decided tetrahedrons result from a combination of faulting, uplift, water erosion, and huge spans of time. They have no empirical proof. They have no proof whatsoever that water erosion can produce repeating, harmonic, and nearly perfect geometric forms like these shown here, and many others presented in earlier chapters. water erosion simply cannot be that consistent, and the Earth scientists merely have an unverified hypothesis they represent as fact confirmed by consensus, and they ignore the patterns. Ignoring the obvious is scientific malpractice. These forms are, without doubt, from sonic shockwaves. Tetrahedrons are formed in the separation bubble of a reflected shockwave. It's a region where a tetrahedral zone of low pressure forms. This low pressure zone attracts neutral and ionized dust like a vacuum cleaner equipped with an electrostatic precipitator. The separation bubble is electrically and pressure polarized from the incoming plasma winds, causing static electric attraction of ionic dust. There are also magnetic fields to attract ferrous materials and identifiable bands and sheets that conform to the shock patterns. On an electric Earth, the means and mechanisms are all there to form mountains. Wind, water, dust, and electrical bonding. Wind, water, earth, and fire. Mountain features match shockwave forms in excruciating detail far beyond the unambiguous tetrahedral shape of the separation bubble. There are harmonic frequencies, unstable waveforms, subsurface reflections, constructive and destructive interference patterns, and expansion fans found in geology, not once or twice coincidentally, but over and over and over again. All are empirical proofs because the same features have been produced in supersonic wind tunnels for decades. That said, exploring mountains and researching the electric Earth is like an Easter egg hunt, with surprising evidence around every bend. Sometimes the evidence is so cool, so unexpected, and so hidden in plain sight that it knocks even my socks off. So in this final chapter of Eye of the Storm, I'd like to share my three favorite Easter eggs. This is a photo of the Dragoon Mountains in southern Arizona. Historically, the Dragoons are famous for Cochise Stronghold, a maze of rocky defiles where Chiricahua Apache raiding parties eluded capture from United States soldiers during the Apache Wars. The Chiricahua chief, Cochise, was a recognized genius at guerrilla warfare, and he used the southern Arizona terrain strategically to stage raids and then vanish. He's supposedly buried somewhere in those rocks above the stronghold. If you look at these ragged pinnacles and sheets of rock stacked together like triangular dominoes, you might be tempted to agree with geologists and say, gee, it must have taken millions of years. But I can show you it happened pretty quickly. The evidence is in this monolithic granite tetrahedron. The tetrahedron has a drip on it. A drip, meaning the tetrahedron was deposited as a viscous mass, like candle wax or hot fudge. The drips are highlighted in the next image. Directly above the drips are pillow-like rocks capping the crown of the tetrahedron. The pillow rock above the drip at far left is broken. It's not a volcanic lava flow. These rocks are granite and must bake under pressure deep underground for immense time, according to science. These fluid forms have been exposed to atmosphere since they were made, because you can't have free flow under tons of overburdened pressure. It's not that it's unusual to see fluid shapes in granite boulders. Granite rocks show fluid puddling, settling, and drop configurations all the time. Even drips, but they're always broken and hard to discern with a photo. But this one is huge and so obvious. At the base of this drip, there's fluting, where the falling sheet flow of fluid solidified in motion, like the mineral deposits from sheet flow on cavern walls. Below the end of the drip are splatters and drops that fell free and landed on the rock face below. A boulder with a runny nose makes no sense in consensus geology, so they ignore such a thing or insist it's not there, but it is. And it's one minor confirmation of electric Earth theory. It also presents loads of information about how it happened and the environment on Earth at the time. The elongated pillow rocks are at the tip of the tetrahedron, and therefore they constitute some of the last matter deposited into this separation bubble. This matter was deposited in a fluid state, and it cooled into a crystalline matrix of granite from the outside in. Like candle wax, it formed a skin that retained heat inside it, keeping the inside molten for longer. They are also at the top of the tetrahedron and stayed hot longest because they had the massive rock below them radiating through. It likely took years for this rock mass to cool down. The pillows hang over the leeward side of the tetrahedron, so the wind was from behind, pushing them over the edge, elongating their shape like water balloons. The separations between rock is where shock waves, charged with current, evaporated material away or prevented it from depositing, leaving gaps. Shock waves in this environment were not only from the winds shearing and deflecting, but also explosive lightning strikes and reverberating thunder. They tend to electromagnetically align parallel and orthogonal, since the winds themselves were aligned with electric fields, and the shock waves carried current. The rock shrank as it cooled, creating the pillow shapes. The largest pillow drop burst, leaving a broken pillow, and its contents spilled out in a stringy drip. In fact, the top of the broken pillow displays lightning scars that likely caused the pillow to break and drip its viscous guts before it completely solidified. Other pillars squeezed out their fluid like toothpaste. I show this example because it illustrates the kind of confusing geologic detail electric earth theory can explain with ease, proving it's not really confusing at all. It just takes breaking through the matrix of false paradigm and looking with fresh eyes. It also gives a sense for the way matter was flying through the atmosphere. There was a fire hose of hot silica in the plasma wind that formed the Dragoon Mountains. It formed like jello in a mold as ions recombined in the suction of separation bubbles. To be clear, this mountain building event occurred in Earth's primordial past, near the end of a period when the continents were forming. There are mountains chock full of fossilized dinosaurs and sea life in strata of this age, but no evidence of man. There were severe plasma storms in human history, but not filled with a fire hose of molten silica. Ancient people did experience coronal storms due to some planetary conflict in the solar system. Ancient myth is pretty clear about that. They must have been less powerful, however, than what's been described here, yet still carried much more punch than they do today. And this next Easter egg tells that story.